Thank God.
That's good. Jay Wu Windham. And he's going to be speaking to us on some things. I have known Jay for, right at 3 years now. I guess we spent 3 years together working in this place. He has worked more on this building than I have, but, it's pretty amazing. The thing that I've come to learn about Jay, though, is that as great as he is at working on things and creating and crafting, when he speaks and teaches, he has something worth hearing. Every time I've heard him speak, he has something worth hearing. And just giving a little bit of a taste of what he's talking about earlier today in the conversation with him, I know that he's got something that God's laid on his heart tonight. So I ask you to listen in a little more closely than perhaps you would need, I guess. Jay has got something really, really powerful tonight. So would you welcome Jay?
So all the other weeks of the semester, I don't have anything worth hearing?
No.
Is that what that means? I only have something worth hearing once a semester. Tonight, I want to talk to you about heroes, and specifically some heroes of our faith. In our world today, I think it's kind of hard to have a unanimous moral hero. Someone can do an entire life of good things, and it can all be undone by one negative thing. Point out anyone who's consistently remembered as great, and you will have naysayers who say, yeah, they did all these great things, but they did this one bad thing, or they said this one thing, or maybe even they said or did something that wasn't bad, but they supported something that eventually led to something that somebody may take as negative. They may have done something that we consider morally repugnant, and I think that's sad because it's kind of hard to find heroes today. Anybody who is good, I feel like we want to see them fall and fail, and a lot of times I feel like we end up worshiping and making heroes out of people who have no pretense of being good. And I guess, I don't know, we would rather have somebody who is open about, negative things in their life than, maybe somebody who we try to uphold as kind of a moral authority. I see this especially in the church, and especially in Christian figures. We see pastors who get big and famous, and it's almost like people are wishing for them to fall and fail. He's not I guess he's all right. Y'all liked him as soon as he graduated, and none of you were even in school here when Tebow played for Florida. But kind of like Tebow, like he's this Christian image in college athletics, and I don't know. I felt like, of course, a lot of people supported him because of that, and I know you guys are kind of okay with him now that he's on SEC Nation and he's not playing against you anymore. I don't know many Alabama fans who don't smile when you think about Tebow crying. I don't know. That's not necessarily a moral failure. I think it can be good. I think it can be good that we don't uphold people as perfect. We see people as the fallen sinners that they are. And so I think that's one good thing that we don't no offense, Luke, we don't turn people into saints, or we turn only certain people into saints, and after they've been dead for a few years, and yeah, they're rules, but we don't turn living people into saints, I think that can be good, but I think it's bad on the other hand, because we end up missing out on a lot of fantastic people of faith because we think, oh, well, maybe they did something wrong, or you just kind of assume that they're hiding something. Because some people have issues, I guess all people have issues, we're all sinners, some people have a problem with calling people great. I personally don't. I think there are great people, and I think there are perfect people, and I think the perfect people. There's only one. So I think there is a difference between calling somebody great and calling somebody perfect. And so I want to talk about some of these great people tonight. If you have a problem with calling somebody great, try to focus more on their great acts. Don't let that distract you, and see how God was able to use this flawed, sinful person to do great things. So, what makes someone great? This is something that author Eric Metaxas tries to tackle in two of his books that I have been dabbling in, called Seven Women and Seven Men. Eric Metaxas is a Christian author and biographer. He wrote a biography on two of the people contained in these books, and there was, I think, interest in other people like this. And instead of writing exhaustive biographies like he has on Dietrich Bonhoeffer and William Wilberforce, he wrote smaller chapters on seven men and seven women. In these books, he tries to look at them, examine their lives, and figure out the secrets to their greatness. So seven women, he chose seven Christian women, and they were Joan of Arc, Hannah More, Susanna Wesley, Maria Skopitsova, Corrie ten Boom, Mother Teresa, and Rosa Parks. So some of those you may know, some of those you may kind of be familiar with, some of those you may probably have never heard of. The seven men he chose were George Washington, William Wilberforce, Eric Liddell, Dietrich Bonhoeffer, Jackie Robinson, Pope John Paul II, and Chuck Colson. So these people all lived within a 500-year window of each other. And besides Pope John Paul II and Mother Teresa, I don't think any of these people ever met or interacted with each other. If they did, it was by chance. And I think JP2 and Mother Teresa just met each other briefly. Anyways, tonight I want to look at two of these people and talk about their lives, see what we can learn from there, and I'm going to bring this together and take one big lesson that I think we can learn from really all of these people, but especially the two that I'm going to bring up tonight. So first I want to talk about Eric Liddell. Is anybody in here familiar with Eric Liddell? Okay, if this was 80 years ago, that would probably be yes. I anticipate that, unless there's, I don't know, some kind of nerd in here. Eric Liddell may not be as well known a name to you today, but I will almost guarantee you are familiar with one thing about Eric Liddell, and that is a soundtrack that goes along with a famous movie about them. Sound familiar to anybody? Just wait for it. The 2012 Olympics, Mr. Bean was on stage performing this. So we can fade it out, but I like it. It's a good song. Sometimes, when Wade and I were running, training for the half marathon, I would have that song in my head. Eric Liddell was a sprinter, so he would already be finished with his race, and I'd probably have to sing that 1,000 times over and over again in my head to finish a half marathon. Anyways, Eric Liddell was a runner. I don't know if you even know what goes along with that tune, but that is kind of the main theme from the 1982, early 80s movie, Chariots of Fire. So some of you may have seen that. I saw it a long time ago. I need to rewatch it. It's not on Netflix, so I can't. So Eric Liddell was a runner. He was Scottish, although he was born in China in 1902. His parents were missionaries, and this was around the time of the Boxer Rebellion. I don't know if you remember this from your history classes, but it was a pretty dangerous time to be a foreigner, a foreign Christian, or even a Chinese Christian in China. As a young boy, he moved back to Scotland, where he attended school, and he excelled both academically and in athletics. Before he even went to university, Eric, who was very shy but serious about his faith, used his athletic prowess as an opportunity to share his faith, and he spoke to student groups. He gained training and notoriety when he was running for the University of Edinburgh. While studying there, he actually set the British record for the 100-meter race. He was a sprinter. So because of that, and this was 1923, he made the British Olympic team for the upcoming 1924 Olympics, which were taking place in Paris, and he was set to run the 100, 200, and 400-meter races, the 100-meter being his best event, and he was considered one of the favorites. Months before the Olympics, if you've seen the movie, they make it a little bit more dramatic than it was, but it was still pretty dramatic. Months before the Olympics, the schedule was released, and Eric was dismayed to find out that the heats for the 100-meter, his preferred event, were going to take place on a Sunday. For a devout Christian like Eric, this was a problem. He really took the Sabbath seriously. He saw it as a day for worship and rest. It was something that was supposed to be separated unto God, and he decided that he was not going to be able to run in this heat, which would disqualify him from running in the semifinals or the final for the 100-meter race in the Olympics. So you can imagine somebody, I don't know, somebody doing something like that today would make a good story that they would do, and then they wouldn't talk about it again. But this was a big deal in his home country. The British Olympic Committee, they urged him and tried to reason with him. They pleaded, they bargained, and eventually they bullied and threatened him into running on a Sunday. So they were giving him all kinds of excuses like, continental Europe, the Sabbath is really only until noon, so you could run in the afternoon. He's like, that's not how that works. They would say, well, why don't you take another Sabbath, like a different day? And he's like, that's not how it works either. The Olympic Committee realized that they were dealing with a hard-headed guy who wasn't going to change his mind, and they lobbied the Olympic Committee to change the heats or hold additional heats for people who couldn't run because of religious reasons. And the French, always open to religious excuses. That's a joke. They said, no, we're not going to do that. I guess it wouldn't be the French. It would have been the Olympic Committee. I love the French, by the way. Eric, it failed, and Eric was not going to be able to run the 100-meter race, and he settled on running the 200 and 400, which to non-sprinters, non-runners, that doesn't sound like a big difference. It's like, okay, like that's from like here to there, just a little bit longer. But this is a big difference. The 100-meter race and 400 and 200, those are all very different. It wasn't, it wasn't a sure thing at all. Scotland especially felt very betrayed. Scotland had never won in 1924. They had never won an Olympic gold medal. And the Scots felt that Eric was probably their best chance they had ever had to win a gold. Eric was kind of castigated by the Scots. So they go to Paris. Eric watches one of his teammates, who's from England, not Scotland, run and win the 100-meter race. Later that week, he competed in the 200-meter and actually came in third place. So his last event was going to be the 400-meter race. In the heats leading up to that, the favorite for the 400, an American named Horatio Fitch, shattered the world record So it wasn't looking good. Eric was going to be running against him. Also, Eric drew the outside lane of the track, which in the 400, in 100 meter, it's not going to make a difference. In the 400, that's a big difference. For non-runners, that means he's on the outside, and they do a staggered start. So he is going to be the furthest in the front. The benefit being, if you're in the back, you can see all the other runners, you can pace with them, and he's not going to see other runners until they're passing him. So Eric decided that his best strategy was to pray and run as fast as he could, which, I don't know, sounds easy to us. Like, of course, it's the Olympics, you're running, just run as fast as you can. That's not exactly what you do. That's what you do for the 100, but not for the 400. So just before the race, a British admirer came up to Eric and handed him a piece of paper, and it had a scripture from 1 Samuel 2:30 on it, and it said, "Him that honors me, I will honor." So what happened in the race defied logic to any experienced runner. Eric started off way faster than he should have. He was running as if he was running the 100-meter race. He was not pacing himself like he should have for the 400. General consensus was that Eric, being a sprinter, running the 400, a middle-distance race, Eric was going to run out of steam around 50 meters left and pass out. Not only did Eric keep up this pace, as he approached the finish line, he actually lengthened his lead. He not only won the gold medal in the 400, a huge upset, but he beat his nearest competitor by nearly 5 meters, which we don't use meters. It's meters are communist, but that's about 15 feet, which is a big distance in a short race like that. And not only that, but he beat the world record that one of his opponents had set earlier in the day. The following Sunday, when two other races that Eric had to give up, the 4x100 and 4x400, because it was on a Sabbath, Eric was nowhere near the Olympic Stadium. He was actually at the Scots Church in Paris preaching. Eric became a national hero. Even though he gave up running his best race, one that he could have set a world record in, maybe one he could have won gold, because he did what he believed in. I don't know many people that can name many Olympians besides, I don't know, Jesse Owens and Bruce Jenner and people like that before, like Michael Phelps, but Eric is, I don't know, one of the best remembered Olympians from Olympic history, really because of this incredible story. So not only did Eric Liddell participate in that race and run, the story doesn't end there. Shortly after, I think a matter of weeks after the Olympics, Eric once again shocked the world by announcing that he was retiring from running. So the world record holder, one of the fastest men in the world, decided that he was going to retire running because he was answering his call that he had kind of already decided to become a missionary to China, like his parents. Anyways, he leveraged his notoriety to share the gospel rather than becoming a celebrity and living the good life, being one of the fastest men in the world, or the fastest man in the world, if he had participated possibly in the 1928 Olympics. Eric decided to move to Tientsin, China. So he taught there in a Christian environment, gained a name for himself, teaching, preaching, and also as an athletic coach. He was married and had several children. If you know much about history, you may know the next decade may have been fine, but the late 1930s weren't a great time to be in China, because prior to the beginning of World War II, Japan actually invaded China. Mary, I gotcha. Japan invaded China, and some terrible things happened there. Eric and his other missionaries continued their work in the face of adversity, violence, food shortages, and a lot of other hardships. They cheerfully continue to do God's work. Eventually, they are forced into an internment camp where conditions were pretty terrible. They continue to share the love of Christ. Eric eventually, it was found out years later, Eric had an opportunity in a prisoner exchange to leave the country. The British wanted him out, and he actually gave up his spot for a pregnant internee in his camp and decided to stay, leaving his family behind. So about a year before the end of the war, Eric started having severe headaches. As you can imagine, medical facilities in an internment camp aren't going to be fantastic. It was thought that maybe he had a brain tumor, but they really couldn't do much about it at all. He suffered a minor stroke, and a few weeks later suffered another stroke where he fell into a coma and then died later that night at the age of 43. So Eric, this guy who gave up glory for running in the 100 for a much less sure bet, a guy who gave up a budding career as a Olympic star, an athletic star, and then moved to China to be a missionary, and eventually died there, maybe unnecessarily. His last words were pretty fitting for a guy who showed what his life was about. He talked to one of his friends just moments before his final stroke when he fell into a coma, and he talked the need for someone to surrender their will to God in everything they do, and your attitudes, not what you want to do and feel like doing, but what God wants you to do. So Eric lived a pretty powerful life, anyways, go watch Chariots of Fire. Maybe they'll put it on Netflix sometime soon and we can watch it, because I haven't watched in a while. The second person I want to talk about is a woman named Corrie Ten Boom, pretty well-known as well. Again, if we were 50 years ago, you would have heard of Corrie Ten Boom because she was traveling the world. But anybody in here heard of Corrie Ten Boom? Usually they're a handful. She had a movie made about her and also wrote a book called The Hiding Place. And I want to talk briefly about Corrie Ten Boom. Corrie Ten Boom was born in 1892 to a family of Dutch watchmakers in Haarlem, that is in the Netherlands. So the Ten Booms, they were devout Christians living in a Jewish neighborhood. Being surrounded by people who were of a different faith than them did not drive them inward. They were not clannish, but instead they were outgoing in their community, loving one another. They were hardly wealthy, far from wealthy actually, but gained a reputation for being generous, loving to all, and accepting lots of people, regardless of their religious affiliation. Faith, their Christian faith was intertwined with the Ten Booms in their daily life, separating their secular and sacred lives would have been unthinkable, unfathomable to the Ten Booms. They lived out their faith every day. And luckily, they had this faith because the Ten Booms were about to face some pretty tough times. In 1940, shortly after, the start of World War II, Germany invaded the Netherlands. So this was the spring of 1940, after the previous fall, Germany had invaded Poland. Germany attacked on the Western Front and invaded the Netherlands. The faith of the Ten Booms can be seen in their actions on the first night of the German invasion, as they were in their house with lights off, praying as they listened to sirens and bombs being dropped around them. Not only did they pray for their country, for the injured and the dying, but Corey's sister Betsy was actually praying for the Germans up there in the airplanes that were literally dropping bombs on them at that time. With the German occupation, Netherlands surrendered about 5 days later. They were threatened with another air raid, and they surrendered. With the German occupation that came after came the anti-Semitic policies that we're probably all familiar with from history class. Being in a Jewish neighborhood in Harlem, this hit the tin booms especially hard. As things got worse, the tin booms found themselves in a situation where they were taking on more and more responsibility, supporting their neighbors, giving them food, helping them out in different situations. And eventually, when things became very bad, they began taking in their Jewish neighbors and hiding them in their house. Because they were scared of being caught by the Gestapo, they actually had a secret room built into one of the rooms on the top floor in their house, which they called their hiding place, after a verse from Psalm 119. And this is where they would hide their Jewish guests. The tin booms, really following their faith step by step, eventually found themselves to be key figures in the Dutch underground, where they were helping dozens and dozens of Jews find safety, find houses to stay in, and they took seven permanent guests in their house themselves. After a series of truly miraculous close calls, the tin booms were finally discovered, arrested, and imprisoned. The Gestapo was unable to find their hidden room, and all seven of their guests were able to escape safely and survive. Unfortunately, the tin booms were all imprisoned and facing terrible prison conditions, facing illness. Corey and her family tried to focus not only on themselves, but others around them. And something that you will see continuously with Corey and her family, they saw every opportunity, every situation as an opportunity to share their faith and share the gospel. Praying for, praying with, and speaking kindly to even their prison guards. Eventually, Corey and her sister Betsy were transferred to a concentration camp in the Netherlands called Vught. It was here where they learned through other prisoners the person that had betrayed them and turned them in, sent them to prison, the person responsible for their father's death shortly into their prison sentence. Who was elderly and feeble and died just a few days into their sentence. Rather than harboring this anger, the Tin Boom girls prayed for this person. They prayed for their betrayer. They saw him as a sinner who needed forgiveness just like them. And they actually prayed to God that this man wouldn't suffer from guilt for turning them in as they're in a concentration camp. In this camp, again, they saw it only as an opportunity to love others and share their faith. They tried to address the spiritual needs of both other prisoners and their guards, continuously interacting with their guards, the same guards that are beating them and abusing them, and try to make the most out of every opportunity, which personally I would have probably found despair in it, and I imagine many of you would have fought that as well. Along with a lot of the other prisoners at Vught, Corey and her sister Betsy were eventually transported to one of the most notorious camps, Ravensbrück. It was a women's concentration camp in northern Germany. There they faced even worse conditions, frightful living conditions, and amongst these terrible conditions, they found small victories. For which they consistently gave God glory. They really counted it all as joy. You hear that and say, okay, yeah, I can count things as joy when things are going good. These two women in a concentration camp really counted it all as joy, trying to find the good in everything, even in their terrible living conditions. They were in a bunkhouse that was flea infested. The stench was so bad they could hardly stand it. And they tried to encourage one another to find the good in it. And they eventually came to realize that their living conditions were so terrible. But one good thing about that was that they could read their Bible, they could worship, and do all these things without having to worry about the guards busting them, because the guards were literally afraid to go into this house because it was so terrible. Each night, they prayed for the guards that had abused them all day under the smoke pouring out of the nearby crematorium. They read from their hidden Bible, without fear of being caught because of how terrible the conditions they lived in. By the time she was released, Corey was one of the only members of her family who had been arrested that survived. And after the war, having promised her now deceased Betsy, Betsy, to tell their story, Corey began traveling and telling their story about forgiveness, how we need forgiveness from God, and we also need to forgive others. Corey's faith was tested. If you think it wasn't tested and all of that, she said the hardest thing she ever had to do was actually after the war, when she was speaking in a church in Munich, Germany. After the close of the service, where she spoke, I believe this was in 1947, just a few years after the war, where she spoke about forgiveness, she came face to face with a man she recognized. He was actually one of the guards at Ravensbrück. She remembered him and remembered being tortured and abused by this man, this SS member. This man who had mocked and beaten her watched as her sister wasted away and died right in front of Corey's eyes, told her that he had accepted Christ, he didn't remember Corey. He said he remembered, she spoke of Ravensbrück in her speech, but he didn't remember her. She remembered him, but he still asked her for forgiveness. He said he couldn't believe the things that he had done, Corey, in what she called the hardest thing she ever did, raised her hand, took his hand and shook it. And through the power of the Holy Spirit, she says, was able to forgive this former tormentor of her. Corey ended up traveling the world the rest of her life before dying in 1983 at the age of 91. Her story is contained in a book that is fantastic called The Hiding Place, and also in a movie made in the 70s, I believe. So Eric Liddell, Corey Ten Boom, just two of the 14 people in these fantastic books. Can't recommend them enough. Sometimes biographies, you really have to care about a person to get through a multi-100-page book about them. This book is much shorter. It gives you the short and sweet, concise versions, but it's enough still to be powerful, but not too much to be overwhelming. Anyways, these 14 people, as I read about these people, I tried to find kind of connecting points and figure out, all right, these people's lives are very inspiring. How can I apply this? What can I take from these people's lives use this inspiration to affect my life? So as I begin reading, really the one of the, of course, there are a lot of impressive things about these people. They are brave, they are forgiving, they are humble, but one thing that really stood out to me amongst all of these people is they're willing to sacrifice. They really lived lives of sacrifice and lived as if their lives were not their own. Matthew 16:24 is a scripture I want to use here talking about this. Jesus said to his disciples, "Whoever wants to be my disciple must deny themselves and take up their cross and follow me." Each of these people, particularly the people that I brought up tonight, denied themselves of worldly desires and comforts. Each of these people lived lives that the secular world might say were inconvenienced by their faith. It would have been easier to do other things. Some of them deliberately put themselves into harm's way, and some of them gave up secular glory and what the world would say lives that could have been successful to pursue their calling. I want to talk a little bit about sacrifice and selflessness. Selflessness is different than selfishness, so make sure you get that. But selflessness. This idea of selflessness is not just an ideal of Christianity. You'll find this in other places. This is actually one of the main tenets of Buddhism, that the world is evil, there's suffering, and to end that, you need to deny yourself. And I think this is why we see a lot of celebrities that adopt Buddhism, very popular in Hollywood. When you have everything the world can offer and you still aren't fulfilled, which we know why as Christians, I think you start to search for fulfillment in other ways, and self-denial is one of the ways that I think people seek out to do that. So this sentiment, even in amongst Buddhists, of self-denial, I think is based in truth. That God places in our hearts. Romans 2:14, talking about the unsaved Gentiles who do not have the law, do by nature things required by the law. They are a law for themselves, even though they do not have the law. They show that the requirements of the law are written on their hearts, their consciences also bearing witness, and their thoughts sometimes accusing them, and at other times even defending them. So since we're made in the image of God, we have truth. It's entwined with our lives. Truth is hardwired in us. And I think this sentiment of service, of self-denial that you'll sometimes find amongst non-believers and believers of other faith is true. But I think that it's only half of the truth. As we saw in Matthew 16:24 just a minute ago, whoever wants to be my disciple must deny themselves, and then the second part is, and take up their cross and follow me. So denying our desires, I think, is only half the truth. What makes Christians different is not the vacuum that is left when we deny ourselves, but what we fill that vacuum with, what we replace it with. We're not just called to deny ourselves, but to take up our cross and follow him. So one last thing about sacrificing, getting rid of your selfish desires and living a life that is not for you. Do any of you, some of you may be a little too close, so maybe think back further to like middle school or even younger, but do any of you remember when you were in high school and you cared a lot about really important things, but now looking back, you're like, that really wasn't important at all. Why did I freak out so much about this thing that meant the world to me? Anybody feel that way? High school, maybe middle school, maybe even younger. I certainly feel that way. I'm 10 years removed from graduating high school. And I think about all the things that I used to care about that meant so much. And now that you have a little perspective, it doesn't matter all that much. The things we care about a lot of times are very temporary, and you don't realize that until later on. So I want to pose this question. Is it really sacrifice to give up something so temporary for something eternal, something that means so much in the moment but eventually means nothing for something that can mean such a greater thing? I think if you ask Eric Liddell or Corrie ten Boom about their sacrifice, they probably wouldn't consider it a sacrifice. They gave up something that was less valuable, the temporary, for something that they held was much more valuable. So sometimes we think about, oh, I'm sacrificing this small thing so that I can spend more time in my relationship with God. Is it really a sacrifice if you're giving up something small for something much more valuable? In the Old Testament, we see this with Abraham and Isaac. Abraham is asked to sacrifice his son Isaac. I won't go into the backstory, but Isaac, the son that he had waited 100 years for, that God had promised him and made him wait. God asked Abraham to sacrifice Isaac. And if you remember from looking at the scripture, we don't necessarily go into Abraham's head. He's probably questioning some things, but Abraham willingly does this without asking God why. He binds Isaac and is ready to sacrifice his beloved son, who he loved dearly. That's what he'd spent his life waiting for. But Abraham was ready and willing to sacrifice his son, who was incredibly valuable to him, for something much more valuable, his relationship with God. That doesn't mean that everything's going to be hunky-dory. This is just my interpretation. But if you look in Genesis and look at Abraham and Isaac, there's no other mention that I know of them ever having a conversation after that. So they could have been BFF after that still. But as you can imagine, your relationship might be kind of weird with one of your parents if they tried to sacrifice you. So they had a knife and were ready to stab you and set you on fire. Your relationship may be a little strange. So that doesn't mean everything's going to be perfect. But sometimes pursuing God, as seen with Eric Liddell, I'm not telling you to sacrifice your children, as seen with Eric Liddell and Corrie Ten Boom, sometimes it's going to cost you your livelihood. It's going to cost you your family. And in some people's cases, it may even cost you your life. But I want you to think of this, these sacrifices not as a major sacrifice. I think in a lot of ways, it's not much of a sacrifice at all when you are giving up something temporary and not as valuable for something that is eternal, and eternal joy. Mark 10:29-30 says, Jesus is talking here. Truly I tell you, Jesus replied, no one who has left home or brothers or sisters or mother or father or children or fields for me in the gospel will fail to receive 100 times as much in this present age, homes, brothers, sisters, mothers, children, and fields, along with persecutions, and in the age to come, eternal life. So think not in the temporary, but the eternal. So I want to close talking a little bit about application. So I want you to ask yourself some questions as you think about these people, and I'll rush out and buy these books and read them and get inspired yourselves. What do you need to sacrifice? Sometimes even good things, or things that may not be seen as inherently sinful or worldly. What things do you need to sacrifice to pursue your calling? And what distractions, even good distractions, are standing in your way? We sometimes have good distractions. Few people would have faulted Eric for staying and running, continuing to preach and use his athletic prowess as a platform to share the gospel. People would have maybe even said that was God's plan for him. But he knew that something like that, a comfortable life of notoriety, was not what God was calling him to. He was calling him to a life as a missionary. Who would have blamed Corrie Ten Boom for trying to keep her family safe and helping out maybe in very safe ways her neighbors who were facing persecution and even death? Sometimes something that looks good and sounds good may not be necessarily what God is calling you to, and sometimes it's just a distraction from what your actual calling is. Sometimes they seem logical, but they're distractions nonetheless. So what is God calling you to do, and what distractions are keeping you from doing this? And I want to encourage you, like we see in Mark 8:35-36, to pursue the most valuable thing in your life. Lose your life for the gospel. Lose your life in Christ. And remember that he who gives up his life is the one who truly lives. So if you will, bow your heads and pray with me. God, we thank you for the examples that people who have walked these steps ahead of us set. God, we thank you for the stories that these great titans of faith have set, and the inspiration that we can glean from these stories. Father, I pray that this idea of sacrifice and selflessness will be one not only that we dwell on and think about, but, Father, that we actively try to implement in our daily lives. Father, I pray that you point out distractions that are preventing us from our actual call. God, even ones that we may not see as inherently sinful. God, I pray that you point that out in us Father, lead us into the people that you would want us to be. And Father, I pray that you guide our steps along the way. It's in your name we pray. Amen.